let's go into the next family, which is SOPs, which is surface operators, which is where you would create your geometry, where you would make pretty pictures that are not textures, but 3D. So I went out of this chops container, and let's just make another container. So hit tab, find the components, and add a base component, and call this SOPs. And let's go inside this SOPs container. Oh, saving, Control S. So SOPs are, what's the difference between textures, tops, and SOPs? Textures are just pixels. So you just have per pixel on your screen, you just have the information for its RGBA value. That's all you get. With SOPs, you have surface operators. So what you actually get is positional data in space, and attributes such as normals and tangents, and if it's particles, you have particle life or whatever. So it's a different way to describe things, although all of this is then displayed on 2D screen again as pixels. To explore this, let's just hit tab and bring up the subfamily. And there's a couple of generators here, and a couple of filters. So what we'll pick is the sphere sub to start with. And I showed you earlier, you can always activate the viewer, and perhaps the SOPs are one of those families where you use the viewers quite a bit. What you can do here is you can look at it in wireframe mode, you can navigate around. There's a whole menu hidden underneath this viewer. If you right click and go to display options in this pop-up in the viewer right click menu, then now you get things like you want to look at all the points, or you want to see the point numbers or the point normals. So you get all this information inside the viewer. Wireframe is W, by the way. And again, most of these keyboard shortcuts, if you right click, you get them, they're listed here. Okay, home. And one of the nicest filters, as usual, would be noise. Just add noise, always helps. So right click on the output of the sphere and pick the noise stop. And what you get is a sphere that's being animated, the positions of the sphere being animated by a noise, which you have control over by other parameters. So you can change the period of the noise, or what kind of noise it is. Now, maybe I want to render this whole thing, because what I have now is just a sphere that's animated by noise and nothing else. I just have, it's not pixels yet. To render a scene, you would require a camera, a light, usually, and a material, like how to shape the whole sphere, how it should look like. And you need something else, which is called a geometry component. The geometry component, it's always a little bit hard to explain what it actually does. It kind of moves it from being a surface operator into something that's renderable. I really don't have a better explanation right now. So if you right click, all of these things that I just mentioned are actually components. They are not members of the subfamily, but they're members of the component family. So let's start with the geo component. And the geo component is something that encapsulates the SOP that is being rendered. The easy setup for this, and you can follow me along and just... So if you right-click on the output of the noise, and now go to the component family, and now find the geometry component in the first column, and place it down, it kind of creates... I know I said earlier that you can only connect blue nodes to blue nodes and green to green. So what's about this, that you can suddenly connect the SOPs to a container? It's not really connecting it to a container. It's taking a container and creating an input and an output, and you're connecting to those inputs and outputs, which are actually in the family, in the subfamily. Anyway, this is just right-click on the SOP that you want to, on the output of the SOP that you want to render, and create a geometry component. Next, I said we need a camera. So let's find a camera in the components. And all these geometry-related things are in the first column here. So we have a camera. And let's add a light. Okay, we have a light. Now we need to render it. And rendering means taking all this 3D positional data and whatever and moving it into the pixel world. So the render is actually a top. So we need a render top. So hit tab and go to the top family and find the render top. Place it there. Now I'm just going to add a null to it. Right click on the output, add a null, and hit the display flag. And you have your first real-time 3D animation here. It's very spectacular. Yes?
Quick question. Does it matter where we get the null from? Like, if it's a null, does it have to be from the right operator category?
Yeah. Just because you can only connect the same colors to each other, so that's the main reason. That's correct, yeah. If you try to wire it up to, it only gives you a couple nodes which can reference other nodes, basically. Yeah. So this is a very gray sphere, and it requires a material to make it colorful. Now, that's the next family, and you already see this is kind of, to set up something that renders requires at least four different families. Because you have the SOPs, comps, tops, and now you add the mats to it. And materials, we have, well, some. We have Phong material, which is it's a very basic material. And now the Phong, if you place the Phong down, there's no reference between the geometry and the material yet. You need to reference them. So click on the geo component, and the geo component has on its render page a material parameter, and that's where the material goes into. So the geo component on the render page, the material parameter, drag the Phong onto that. Now, how do I know that it's referenced? Mostly because on the Phong parameters, I can now start changing color. Like the diffuse color or something. or perhaps I can add color maps to it. Now, color maps are pixel-based, so it's tops. So I'm just going to create a movie file in. And theoretically, I could put my banana here onto the color map. Or, choose any other image that you like to see on there.
I'm having trouble dragging the form into the material. Did you set it to be the display mode? The viewer active mode? Because I had that.
Because it's
yeah, if your viewer active mode is on, if you hit that plus, yeah. And now try doing it.
If you have, that's a UI issue for us, because when you activate the viewer, you don't have the frame anymore to drag it. You are actually interacting with the viewer. So with the viewer active, a way to still drag it would be by grabbing it by the name. You can still change the name here by double-clicking onto it to add to the confusion of it all, but easiest is to disable the viewer and then drag it.
That's a little bit different, though, than the other with the numerical value, because the other one references the actual value, isn't it? Where this is referencing more like, it's just telling it the address. It's sort of like you could just type the address, the name in there.
You could just type it in there, correct, yeah. Yeah, this is,
and that's all, you could reference something in our tops folder as well, couldn't you?
Yep.
By going like .../.
Yeah, across large networks, you can grab operators here. And these operator, you have the same with the renderer, because the renderer doesn't take inputs from comps or from anything else. You need to reference them by parameter.
You could still drag it in, like if you have them with multiple panes set up, then you can drag it across, and then it'll automatically complete all the reference.
Yep.
Like it'll make it an absolute or a relative.
Yeah. Yeah, it gives you, it usually gives you relative paths. This is something, I didn't get into pane, like network pane layouts. But there's a button up here that's called pane layout, and there's a couple predefined pane layouts which might make sense to click now. So if I take the split pane here, I have two networks now, which is the same network, but now I can go to a different place here. And as you say, take this top from my RGB, and then I have the chance to either have it as a relative op path or an absolute op path. And you see the address here, ./. And you can always, when you have these multi-pane setups, to control them, there's here the drop-down menu for them. It's this little down arrow. And here you can close a pane again. And have that. A special, back to materials, a special material type that we just added, which is very, very useful, is something called PBR materials, physical based rendering. These are the easiest way to feed them is by using Substance Designer generated materials. Substance Designer is another software where you can create materials. So you create all the normal maps, bump maps, metallic maps, whatever, roughness. And these files can be brought into Touch with the help of something called the Substance Top. It's a Substance Top. The way that there's an example substance designer file that comes with TouchDesigner. The way that they're set up, often you have multiple materials in one substance file. So we could, for example, choose checkers. And you see it has here all the different maps in one view. Now you need to reference this substance in the substance top parameter on the maps page of the PBR mat. And then apply the material again the same way as we did with the foam material to the GO1. What definitely works as well, if you don't want to navigate these assigning values to parameters from other nodes or from channels, what definitely works as well is if you take the node and hover over, like I want to assign the node to the render, to the render parameter of the GO1. So I can take the node, hover over the GO1, and the parameters of the GO1 pop up. And now I can hover over the pages of all the parameters of the geo and just drop it in there. This also works with channels the same way. There's two more steps that need to be done with the PBR material. Just something to remember, these PBR materials can be really, you can quickly make something look shiny. That's the maybe a good description of it. But you need two more things to make this all work. One is an environment light, so that you have the right reflections. So an environment light can also be found under the components. It's right in the center of the 3D object section. And the environment light needs an environment map. And the environment map, again, is a top. So I'm just going to take a movie file in, and we have this Palace of Fine Arts that you might use here as an, actually no, you cannot use that. If you copied the Dropbox folder, then inside the day one media, there is a, there's an HDR image under this. So it's the Dropbox folder, day one media HDR. And if you open that in a movie file in, and wait a second. What? No. And I didn't save. Doesn't matter. It's ridiculous.
You said the rooftop one? Is that the one you were choosing?
Yeah.
I'm gonna save it.
Yeah. What the hell?
Which map is the input to the environment?
That would be the HDR under day one media HDR.
Oh yeah, that was probably in the PBR material.
Oh, not in the PBR material, it's the, you just have to put it into the environment map parameter of the environment light. I'm just going to rebuild this here quickly. The nice thing is about touch, you don't have to necessarily create the nodes. If you have media, you can just drag it in. My computer totally doesn't like this. That is very strange. Anyway, that sucks. and it just crashes. Usually when it crashes, it creates a file that's called crashautosave.toe, which you can use to, when you start it up, it comes up all dark gray, and it doesn't cook anything. It doesn't calculate anything. You can go inside and remove nodes where you think that might have caused your crashing, and then hit Control S and bring the file back up in a hopefully running state. And the other thing it should create is a dump file and a little message where it tells you to please send this dump file to us so we can see what's not working. So I do have to skip this PBR example because I cannot make it work unless... unless this one works. Now if I go in here... Doesn't look good. Nope. Anyhow, well, we've got 7 minutes left. Any questions? Oh, okay. Yeah, I mean, I can go. I can go over the. So, what we did without the PBR, just to repeat these, the whole render setup. We had a sphere and added a noise to it, and to render any geometry, just right click onto the output of the SOP that you want to render and attach a geometry. Now again, you need a camera and a light and a material, which I will not choose a PBR but a Phong, and a render top. Now the material itself as a color map accepts any kind of top input, and the top could very well be a video, the feed from your webcam. So by selecting the mat and just add a null here and referencing this node onto the color map parameter. Now I have a material with the video device in with my webcam as the material, and this I can assign to the material parameter of the geometry. Perhaps also when with these conversions between different nodes, that's something I definitely should mention today still. You have, again, nodes can only be connected with these wires if they have the same data context, meaning 3D to 3D, tops to tops, chops to chops, etc. But that doesn't mean that you cannot convert data from one into another, or that you can reference those. So, how does a circle look like as values, as graph values? That's, you can convert a SOP into a chop. So there's a circle SOP there, and now in chops, there's a SOP 2. And here again, I have a SOP reference in the parameter. So if I drag my circle on there, well, big surprise, I see my TX and my TY. And you can do this with anything. So this is just a circle, but if I take my my noise, then here I see the animated values of that. So I can take values from SOPs, convert them into chops, and then make that do something with them, calculate something, I don't know. And there's a good example online, that workshop, we've done that a couple times, where you take an audio, you want to display an it's like an audio visualization where you shoot out particles from a circle to sound. And this would be one example where you convert SOP to CHOP, then use some math in the CHOPs to multiply this with the audio waveform and then move it back into CHOPland to create that audio visualization. That video is online as well. It's good to check that. So you can convert from one to the other. And you can, of course, you can convert back. You can take this CHOP data and now make a SOP out of it. I have, though, to say that you have TX, TY, TZ here, so you only have point information. For the 3D, for this sphere here, you have lots more of information. You have how they are connected, the points and normals and stuff. So if I just convert the TX, TY, TZ now via a CHOP 2 into a SOP, this is what you basically would get. It's a continuous line with all the points connected in order of your as they are in this graph. Now, yes, I can take audio device in. Sorry, not audio device, that's boring. I can take audio file in with two channels. Just gonna copy the CHOP 2. Convert this. Now this gives me a warning because my channels are named Chen 1, Chen 2, but the channel scope parameter here expects TX, TY, TZ. So I'm gonna change that to channel 1, channel 2. And what I get is a audio XY scope, like a stereoscope. I can take also CHOP data and convert it into TOPS directly. So now I have to imagine every value here is just a color value. It's not, I mean, it's 0 to 1 or something, so it can be easily interpreted as color. So in TOPS I find a CHOP 2 as well. So what I get here is, a middle mouse click, I see I have 735 samples and 2 rows, 735 pixels and 2 rows. That's because I have 2 channels, so it generates 2 rows with just R. Can also change that format a little bit. And if I change the resolution of this, let's make it 512 by 512. Now I converted my channels into a bar graph display, which if I want to I'm moving a little fast, I'm sorry, but this is all running out of time. Transform, I can use this, for example, to displace pixel values with the displace top. And what you can create basically is like a little waveform display in TextureLand. The family we totally didn't look at, DATS, has all these converters too. Oops, not clip. We want to have a CHOP 2 again. If you want to look at this data, if you want to look at this audio data and want to see all the values as text, then you can also go this way. Again, this way also you can take DATS and convert back to CHOPs, or take DATS and convert to SOPs. It's all a big circle. And all these displays are just, so you're looking at data in different ways. That's all, it's all the same values, just different viewers in a way. the conversion to SOPs to TOPS would be via the render. And I think I've totally run out of time. Any questions